Good morning. How's everyone's weekend?
It was a great weekend, Abraham. How about yours?
Great weekend.
Great. I want to welcome everyone as well on Facebook Live, just joining us. Any big breakthroughs or aha moments this past week or throughout your weekend? How about awareness and respond or react?
Most definitely has improved. Even my wife and children are starting to act a little differently according to the way that I am.
Good. What have they noticed?
Well, my wife seems to be a lot more relaxed in the moments. And of course, what ends up happening is we react differently to things. So therefore, they react differently. They're a sponge at this moment. So of course, it makes for an easier surrounding whenever they're in the throes of things as kids.
Good. Anyone else?
I find myself realigning, refocusing this weekend, Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
Well, talks we had prior last week, and it kind of bring me right back in track to where I was. I realized, you know, me reading and writing Serenity, you know, mm-hmm. I am grateful. It actually is something I was lacking of doing, and it kind of gets me aligned back on the track on the GPS I had.
Good.
So I feel a lot, you know, this morning I feel a lot more motivated, ready to get it.
Good. Are you writing out Serenity?
Yes, sir.
Comments of Mine?
Yes, sir.
By James Allen. Do that for 60 days. If you miss a day, start all over again.
Yes, sir.
First time I did it, definitely a big change. And every now and then I'll go back to it and I'll do it for 30 days or I'll do it every once in a while just as a check and balance. But it's definitely, you can say, paid off. How many days have you been doing that?
Well, you know, I'm going to say when I started doing it, I did it for, like you said, for 60 days. Then I started jumping days, skipping days. I started reading it and then I stopped. All of a sudden stopped. Saturday I got back on it and then I felt the difference right away because it's something that I had done prior. So yesterday I do it again and I feel that. I feel that alignment and I'm getting in the alignment with my goal. You know, calmness on the mind.
Good. Anyone else writing Serenity?
Which one's a Serenity, Abraham?
It's by James Allen. I think we've sent it out before. Does anybody else want it?
Yes, sir.
What this has done for me every time I read it or I go back and read it, it brings me back in alignment. It almost feels like it centers you back up again. And not only that, it makes you more calm, more understanding, and more focus, more will. I'm going to read the beginning of it. Calmness of mind is one of the beautiful jewels of wisdom. It is the result of long and patient effort in self-control. It is the presence of its presence is an indication of ripened experience and of a more than ordinary knowledge of the laws and operations of thought. A man becomes calm in the measure that he understands himself as a thought evolved being. For such knowledge necessitates the understanding of others as the result of thought. And as he develops a right understanding and sees more and more clearly the internal relations of things by the action of cause and effect, he ceases to fuss and fume and worry and grieve and remains poised, steadfast, serene. The more you read this, the more you understand who I am is. So our mind is a perpetual transmutation of thought energy. Whatever you were previously thinking before, you are perpetually moving that into motion, as well as feeling those emotions because you're feeling the ideas behind it, right? You're feeling the idea as an image, and then you had an emotional attachment attached behind it. The more we understand that by law, whatever we're thinking about must come about, we'll start to regulate this power. I'm going to start our short video. This month we're going with specialized knowledge and how to apply it. General knowledge, again, is just an overview of information. A lot of the general knowledge that we have is for memory. Rarely has it been focused and directed to the definite end of earning money. So we're going to have a little short video on money and what is money. We want to change our program around money as well. Money does not change a person. Money just expresses more of what they truly are. Money just gives you ability to express more of what's already innately inside of you. So money's not bad. Money is used to experience life. A lot of times we have a negative connotation towards money just because the majority of the time we don't have it, or people that have that negative connotation have it because of the lack of. Let me get started on this video.
Isn't any good. Well, a lot of what he said is true. Many years ago, a man gave me this book, Think. Hello there and welcome, I'm Bob Proctor. I'm gonna talk to you about a subject that literally changed the course of my life. It's a subject not many people understand, but those who do sure live a lot better than the ones who don't. You know, a Spanish distiller one time said, "To good life's expensive. There's another way to live that doesn't cost as much, but it isn't any good." Well, a lot of what he said is true. Many years ago, a man gave me this book, Think and Grow Rich. I was flat broke. I had always been flat broke. I had never had any money. I was 26 years old. I had 2 months high school and no business experience. He said, "Bob, you read this, do exactly what I tell you, you can have anything you want." Now, I really didn't believe that, but I believed he believed it. And I said, "All I want is some money. I figured if I had enough money, all my problems would go away." See, I was earning $4,000 a year, but I owed $6,000. If I had paid every cent I owned or earned in 18 months, I would have just broken even. So I really didn't think I was going to be able to change that. Do you know, within a year, I was earning $15,000 a month. I went from $4,000 a year to $15,000 a month within a year. Now, I hadn't got that much smarter. You don't have to be very smart to earn money, but you do have to understand some basic rules. And that's what I want to talk to you about. You'll notice here where we put money up on the screen, there's a young lady there and myself. She is my business partner. And I'm going to tell you, if I ever met anyone that understands money, this lady sure does. Sandy Gallagher is an absolutely brilliant woman. She was a securities attorney when I met her, had been in the banking business, in the law side of it, for 20 years. And she had done $100 billion in business. Now, I found that out by asking her. I said, "How much did you do?" She's $100 billion. I thought, "You mean 100 million?" She said, "No, 100 billion." Now, if you consider it, she was turning banks public. She was buying banks, selling banks, merging banks. So she was dealing in a lot of money all the time. And I thought, that's the kind of person I want to work with. Well, she is my business partner today and has been for the past 10 years. She's absolutely brilliant when it comes to money. Well, that's what I'm going to talk to you about. And that's what I want you to think about. You see, the truth is, you can earn as much every month as you're presently earning in a year. We can show you how to turn your annual income into a monthly income. Now, that may sound like a gross exaggeration, but it is really not. It's the way it happens. Now, here's something that I read in this book when I first started to study it, and I first started to earn some money. It was by Napoleon Hill, and it's called Big Money. Listen very carefully, because when this is done, I'm going to show you how you can execute this. Napoleon Hill said, "When money comes in quantities known as the big money, it flows to the one who accumulates it as easily as water flows downhill." Now, he says there exists a great stream of power, which can be compared to a river, except that one side flows in one direction, carrying all who get into that side of the stream onward and upward to wealth, and the other side flows in the opposite direction, carrying all who are unfortunate enough to get into that side and not able to extricate themselves from it, downward to misery and poverty. Now, he said, every person who has accumulated a great fortune has recognized the existence of this stream of life. It consists of one's thinking process. The positive emotions of thought form the side of the stream which carries one to fortune. The negative emotions form the side which carries one down to poverty. Now, he said, this carries a thought of stupendous importance to the person who is following what we're talking about here with the object of accumulating a fortune. If you are on the side of the stream of power, which leads to poverty, this may serve as an oar by which you may propel yourself to the other side of the stream. It can serve you only through application and use. Merely reading and passing judgment on it, either one way or another, will in no way benefit you. He says, poverty and riches often change places. Poverty may, and generally does, voluntarily take the place of riches. But when riches take the place of poverty, the change is usually brought about through well-conceived and carefully executed plans. Poverty needs no plan. It needs no one to aid it because it is bold and ruthless. Riches are shy and timid. They have to be attracted. Now, of course, we talked about that in The Secret. You've got to attract it. Well, I think you're going to enjoy this. First of all, money has to be earned, and there is a law that governs this whole universe. Everything operates by law. Well, Emerson wrote beautifully, Ralph Waldo Emerson, on the law of compensation. And the law of compensation is exact. The law of compensation clearly states the amount of money you earn will be in exact ratio to these three points. Number one, the need for what you do. The need for what you do. Number two, your ability to do it. And number three, the difficulty there will be in replacing you. Now think of that. Number one, the need for what you do. Number two, your ability to do it. And number three, the difficulty there is in replacing you. Now, odds are pretty good. The need for what you do is already there. You don't have to do anything about that. Number three will be taken care of if you take care of number two. You may want to think about this for a little while. I thought about it for a long while, and I realized it's pretty true. So you see, you only have to focus on one of those three points, and that is number two, your ability to do it. Whatever you're doing, you want to get better at it. Just keep working at getting better at what you're doing. And there isn't any competition. You're the only competition you're ever going to have. Master whatever you do. Master it. Now, I want you to think of this. There are only three strategies for earning money. Just three strategies. Pay close attention. It's M1, M2, and M3. Now, before I start into them, here's something you want to burn into your mind. If you don't teach your children how to earn money, odds are pretty good they're not going to learn. School does not teach us how to earn money. You can go all the way through school. You can go to Harvard, Oxford, Stanford. Won't matter. They do not teach you how to earn it. They'll teach you how to invest it. They'll teach you how to store it. They'll teach you how to count it. But they do not teach you how to earn it. Now, there's three strategies. If you're going to teach your children, you teach them number three. But let's start with number one. Number one strategy is used by 96% of the population, and it won't work. It never has worked. This is where you trade your time for money. You see, this strategy has an inherent problem. It's called saturation. You run out of time. I don't care how effective you are. I don't care how much you earn an hour. You're going to run out of time. You're trading your time for money. It doesn't work. It does not work. Number two is an excellent strategy, but it's only used by 3% of the population. Number two is where you invest money to earn money. Now, people in the number one strategy, they hear about this, and so they squirrel a little bit of what they're earning away and they invest it, but they don't understand how to invest it, and they usually lose it. If you're going to invest money, you really got to know what you're doing, or go to somebody that has proved that they know what they're doing. Number three is where you invest money to earn money. Now, the first two strategies are not the one you want to focus on. Here's the one you want to focus on, number three. It's only used by approximately one person out of 100. This is where this group earns almost all the money. 96% of all the money that's earned goes to a very small select group of people. And I'm going to tell you something. I used to think they were really smart. Some of them aren't very smart. I was earning over $1 million a year. And I started to analyze, what the heck was I doing? How was I doing it? I had stumbled on M3. I didn't know what I was doing, but I was doing it. I had been raised to believe if you're going to earn a lot of money, you got to be really smart. I knew I wasn't that smart, but I was earning a fair amount of money. M3 is used by 1% of the population, but they are 96% of all the money. These people multiply their time by setting up multiple sources of income. Now, that's the strategy. How do you set up multiple sources of income? Well, some people get that mixed up with multiple jobs. That's not multiple jobs. It's multiple sources of income. The truth is, you can set up sources of income where you're earning money while you're sleeping. And it's never been easier than it is today. With the internet and with the way we're working, man, you can make it happen. So here we are back again. What we want to do is show you how to turn your annual income into a monthly income. Now pay attention, because this is super important. It's very, very important. This can be accomplished by having multiple sources of income. You check back in history, you're going to find all wealthy people have always had multiple sources of income. They didn't have one. They had all kinds of different sources of income. I'm not quite sure how many I've got. I don't even look after them. I have somebody else look after them. Sandy's got a team of people, my business partner, that looks after our sources of income. Now keep staying here. Listen to what we're saying. Our world is changing. Make no mistake about it. Do you know Alvin Toffler wrote a book way back around 1970 called Future Shock, and he talked about the changes that were coming. Well, I was working with Earl Nightingale and Lloyd Conant in 1970, and that was a very popular book around the Nightingale Conant Corporation. We were all studying it, and we were laughing at some of the predictions. We'll say this could never possibly happen. Well, move ahead to 40 or 50 years, Toffler fell short. He didn't predict it big enough. Now, he just passed away here a while ago, but he said something before he died that maybe you should remember. He said the illiterate of the 21st century will not be the people who cannot read and write. They're going to be the people who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. Most of what we've learned up to this point, we're going to have to unlearn, and then we're going to have to learn some new rules. Now, I am unlearning and learning all the time. And I'll tell you something I've learned. Our world is changing. It's not getting bigger. The world is getting smaller. It is shrinking. And here's something else. This is very important. You can have business all over the world through multiple sources of income. Here's the question you want to ask. How much do you want? How much do you want? Because you can set up sources of income all over the place. Now, I do have multiple sources of income. Our company structured that way. We train consultants in our business to teach what we teach. They have multiple sources of income. If I were starting over today, I would probably go into network marketing because it is probably the easiest way to set up multiple sources of income. Now, the fact is that most people that go into it never earn any money is another thing. They're just not working with the right people. Study the real heavy hitters. They all have multiple sources of income and they have money coming at them from all over the world. It's a beautiful thing to understand. Doesn't matter where you live, you can be setting up sources of income all over the globe. You can just keep setting them up. You like the idea, don't you? Well, I'm going to tell you something. You are capable of doing this. We teach this in our programs. Now, we don't only teach this way. There's all kinds of ways. And you'll say, well, are all the sources of income that you have the same size? No. Some are bigger, some are small. But they all have one thing in common. Although they're big or small, they all flow in to your bank. That's right. When you have a source of income, it comes into your bank, and it just keeps adding up and up and up. Now, just keep watching. It just keeps coming, and it comes into your bank, big and small. It's a beautiful thing to know. How much do you want to earn? Watch this video often. Share it with your friends. Not multiple jobs, multiple sources of income.
All right, takeaways.
The illiterate of the 21st century is really just those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. That's a pretty powerful statement.
Yeah.
It's really, I truly believe that we're evolving as beings and thought evolved beings. So obviously learning and then being able to unlearn and relearn is going to be crucial in this juncture.
What does that mean? Learn, unlearn, and relearn.
It means if you learn something and then you have these paradigms that govern your existence and perpetual things over and over, and then there's this thing that is you, right? 95% of what you do. Can you stop for a moment and reassess, reevaluate, and see what you're doing, right? It's based on the classes and the things that we're learning. So for your ability to not just learn, but to really just to relearn and unlearn what you've already been taught, that's the most crucial part. Being able to break aside from fear, doubt, and worry, and be able to become a thought evolved being instead of focusing on the five senses. And that's unique.
Rewrite the cells of recognition.
Good.
Replace them with the new ones. Also, you know, what you say, the key point of, you know, the need for what you do, the ability to do it, and the difficulty of replacing you is your ability to do it, your ability to perform and outperform will pretty much bring the other two together.
Correct. How many of you are learning, working on unlearning?
I'm on right now.
I am too.
I've been working on this for a while. Why do we want to unlearn?
That's the only way we're going to do our quantum leaps.
It's the only way to change your paradigm.
There you go. There may be some of you guys that are new to this and starting to watch the information that we're sharing and that we're teaching. But whether we understand this or not, we've been programmed since childhood. And what that means, we received a mental program. And that mental program is the root to our understanding. It's the way we think. So we received this base knowledge. We received based information according to the genetic coding and environmental coding. According to that coding, those are our cells of recognition. If I were to say car, if I were to say refrigerator, if I were to say dog, you're not going to see my car, you're not going to see my house, you're not going to see my refrigerator, you're going to see yours. So everything that you have around your hair was developed through your cells of recognition. Could be some new cells of recognition that you've adapted and brought in. But in a general rule of thumb, your foundational structure is based on the beliefs from your past. And through these beliefs of your past, they keep presenting themselves into your future states. If you look around your home and you look around your house and you look at the way all the things around you, you're going to start to see that there's a pattern. And this pattern has never really left you because it's part of the way you think. It's part of your operating system. The mind is a perpetual transmutation of thought energy. You keep perpetuating the same thoughts. That's why you can't get unstuck. Some of you may have looked in the past and you look to a city and you look to the city from far away. You see all these lights. And you wonder, how does everyone fit in there? And how do they fit in there according to their lifestyle? What makes one man different to the other? What makes one man rich and one man poor? What makes a city have an average monthly income program? Why is it that you can go to a city and the average of the city probably be $40,000 to $50,000 annually? Why is that so? Because that's what they were programmed to do. And then if you can go over there and you can find somebody that could be making $100,000 a year, and they're still more or less living in the same neighborhood, even $60,000, $50,000, $60,000, and you'll find people that are earning $100,000, they're living more or less the same way. Why?
They're comfortable. They're comfortable in that state of being, which is that paradigm, which is all this around. So it's synergy, right? Everything falls back to the mean. So if there's many in a room or together work, working, synergy will always come with every, to whatever degree that may be.
So we're talking about money, but money is energy. And the better we understand money and that we can attract money, we can set up models for money, we can change our state of being, the way we experience life. That's what it's all about at the end of the day. It's changing the way we experience life. He said money, when it comes, it can come so fast and so quick, just like a stream. What is he talking about?
Money can come so fast, like a stream. If we picture it like water, then we're made of 95% water. So allow it to be water and let it flow to you. It's just one of his affirmations, his beliefs.
If I were to get electricity and they connect it to the house, it has limitless potential because it has full power. If I were to run around the house and I put 10 to 20 bulbs in there, what will I experience?
Latency in the electricity.
Less energy.
Yes.
Was there not full power at the junction of the box? But if I go around and I put 10 watt bulbs all through the house, what am I going to get? 10 watts of experience.
Right. Pretty straightforward.
You only get 10 watts of experience. Now, they say the average human uses 5 to 7% of their mind. Potential power that's infinite, but they only get to express a bit of it. Infinite, but it only releases a small amount of that perfection. What do you think is holding the resisting or holding the expression of that bulb?
The definition of ourselves.
Yeah.
What is our?
It's the beliefs. Now, in the bulb, it would be a mechanism, and it can tie right into all source, but it can only express what it was designed to express. That bulb can only express what it was designed to express. Now, that means it could have all the potential flow, but it's only going to release the experience of what it was created to do. Some of you may think, well, that's not fair. To the bulb, maybe not. But to a human, we can do anything we want. What has been holding every human back from experiencing the perfection that's behind, that's in spirit, it's in a higher state? What's limiting our ability to express what we want out of life?
Our mindset.
There you go.
And the perception of the I am. What is your I am? That is the definition of you.
It goes back to the beliefs. Wherever we were raised, they were writing the program. And according to the program and those beliefs, this perfection that rides inside of us is now expressing itself through those ideas. You may think of the past. Well, you really may think about this. He is right. Everywhere you go, you see the expression of beliefs. Everywhere you go, you see the expressions of decisions and choices that were made. You see the expression, the experience of a mindset. And at the root, you're going to see that the beliefs are the foundation of what's created the programming. The programming came in and it was put in as base knowledge. If the individual never wakes up, he stays a victim of circumstance. He stays a victim of all these things outside of him. He becomes a victim of reality. But that's not the truth. You were never a victim. You didn't understand your power. You see, we were programmed. It's our responsibility to rewrite the program. And that's what we teach here. We teach individuals how to rewrite the program because that's the root to all creation. If I come into that house, I know that that house has limited potential. I know that this body has limitless potential. I know that this body has limitless potential. But then it's my responsibility to draw that out. It's my responsibility to release that. And it's my responsibility to unlearn and relearn. That's the reason he said at the beginning, the illiterate of the future will be the one that could not or would not.
Yes. Life is merely cause, which is your effect. So whatever your cause is your effect. It's nothing personal.
It's the impersonal life. You get what you are. Mm-hmm. Any other takeaways? And I believe somebody had a question here. Can you guys hear us fine?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir, we can.
I believe somebody had a question. Dustin?
Dustin, do you have a question? I'd like to be saying hello.
Maybe just saying hi. Does anyone have a question or something they want to discuss?
So I have a thought that brings me back to when this first started. And this question of how do I test this out for my own life? Because I know that there's others, people I've chatted with, they're just now learning this.
Mm-hmm.
And their question is, you know, I'm not sure if I totally understand or totally grasp it. Is there a way that they can test this? You know, for me, it was like, front parking space. Yes, I wanted front parking space. So I pictured it in my mind every time and I saw it over and over again. And eventually that came to me. Is there something we can do to test that in our own lives to show us a bit of understanding and knowledge? I mean, yes, we have to believe it, but of course, it's always helpful to see a tangible result.
The human is so physical. It's so physical. We want to, the only way we believe something is that we see something. Yes. Yet you see the truth thrust upon you every day and you don't question it.
Yes. Very true.
You see the truth thrust upon you every day and you don't question it. You'll see the monthly statement. You'll see the monthly income. You'll see the house, the car, your environment. You see all these things around you, but you don't question what you've been doing. You couldn't have the house, you couldn't have the car, you couldn't have the revenue, you couldn't have the everything that's physical around you without one, trading it for money, so you had to have money. Two, you couldn't have it unless you brought that upon yourself. The question was, is who brought that upon yourself? Who brought those realities? Who brought that refrigerator? If you want to, let's go to the physical state of things and we'll work backwards. I don't like working backwards, but we work backwards. Now, backwards is physical man wanting to touch physical things and manifest physical things. They just want the physical medium of things.
Yes.
Now, I can go touch the refrigerator. Who put the refrigerator there? Who attracted it? Who attracted the boyfriend? Who attracted the girlfriend? Who attracted the wife? Who attracted the community you chose? Who attracted the car? Who attracted everything around you? If we start looking at the law of attraction, which is three-dimensional, and it's a result, understand that's a result. You're looking at a level of awareness attracted that. You could not deny that. A level of awareness attracted all those things. The only reason you don't have more right now is because you don't have the level of awareness to attract that. But you worked so perfectly before. That means your mindset and the way you think has been working. That perfection inside of you has already demonstrated that I use this law of creation, that I use this law of cause and effect. I thought and I became. I thought and I wielded him into my life. I thought of that person and I attracted that person. I thought of that man and I went up to him. He came up to me. I attracted him. I wanted that house and I attracted that house. I wanted. When we really start to look back, it was the want and the desire. Then the law of attraction came into form. The only difference is you don't know how to want and you don't stay wanting somewhere, something else, because the belief doesn't support it and you give up on your dream. All it was your belief in the desire. If the desire was too big, you just let it go. But yet it's worked so perfectly before. What did you meet?
Met yourself.
Ah, you met the level of your belief. You met the fiber of your cells of recognition. There was no more cells of recognition. Therefore, you met the limitation of what? Your ability to attract.
Your paradigm.
Now, I'm gonna put this in here. And I want you to look at this. This is the way energy works. Each and every one of you know when you've been stuck. Each and every one of you know that you're stuck right now. Each and every one of you know that some of you know that you're growing right now. Some of you are not aware that you're still growing. This mind is a perpetual transmutation of thought energy. It never stops. It's always willing and it's always growing. Some of you are deciding what you're growing and deciding where you're going. Very few. But the masses, do not understand this information. And they don't want to understand it. They don't want to grow. Because they don't understand. My mind can create and attract anything it would want to desire. As we think, we vibrate. As we vibrate, we attract ideas, and they come on here to the screen of our mind. My mind, your mind. If I say cat, whoop, here, game of cat, you can see the cat. Who's cat? Whatever cells of recognition that you have. We have this filing cabinet where we pull a storehouse of information. Files and files of information. When I say dog, up came a dog. When I say rabbit, up came a rabbit. How is it that I keep stimulating your mind and pulling up different images? Because I am activating your cells of recognition, and they come popping up here in the screen of your mind. You see, whenever you went to go outside of what you were programmed to do, and you kept getting stuck and you couldn't break free, producing results in life, you're right here in the physical plane. You see, we don't see what's going on up here. It's unseen. This is up here. This is above 3D. This is 4D up. You cannot see the no thing. 4D up, you cannot see thoughts. But you can see the expression of them down here. 3D world. You can see the expression of your thoughts in the 3D world. Now, when you're thinking and you started to want to think to go further than what you were programmed to do, again, we were programmed. I was programmed. You're programmed. Each and every one of us came into a body. Spirit came into a body. Here's spirit. Spirit came into a body. And here it comes into the body. The mind is a perpetual transmutation of thought energy. Whatever's ringing that bell and you keep thinking about is what you're attracting. This is the raison d'etre, and whatever you keep tapping on this thing and it's vibrating, it's going to attract. You can only attract what you are because you were programmed. You have cells of recognition in here. So every time you think, and if you keep going to this box, you're going to keep moving this body. This is the body. The body is the instrument of the mind. But if the mind keeps thinking from the position of this program, it can only keep reproducing the same reality. You're living in your world right now, not by accident, but because that's what you were destined to become. And you were destined to experience because that's your mindset. Mind, it's set. Does anyone have any questions?
There was something that you had said, I think, Saturday. I think you said it. You said, it's okay not knowing. Well, you know, that's the problem.
Correct. Because what you know is what you create. And you can't go further than yourself.
Yep.
If you're not willing to unlearn and relearn, you stay stuck. If you're not okay with unlearning, some of you may be listening to this for the first time, but if you If you don't want to unlearn and relearn, it's so painful, it hurts to think. That's the problem. It's so painful, it hurts to think. A lot of people don't want to, or want to face their fears. Why would anyone choose to keep living the same lifestyle? Some of you have been on the class. Why would so many people, if you look back, you guys made a decision to work on yourself and unlearn and relearn. I want you to go back to the very beginning when you first came into this information. What's the difference between you now and the person that you came in as when you first came in?
Mess. All over the place. Nerves.
Level of awareness.
Yeah.
If you guys think back right now, why is it that so many people don't want to unlearn?
Fear, doubt, worry.
They're comfortable where they're at.
Yeah.
Where they're at is home.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They're afraid not to step out.
But they feel their paradigm doesn't let them think outside the box, that they don't see what's going on. They don't, the new program coming in, if they ever come across it, they deny it. They don't believe it. It's just like, it's just their program. You know, I was talking to my brother this weekend and I was telling him about staying positive and what you throw out to the universe. And he found every way that's out there to tell me it's not just that. You know, he was trying to convince me, and I gotta go. Well, that's pretty much what it is they don't want to learn.
I mean, you gotta think about it. What do you have to lose, right? Because you've done it right for so long to this point, right? If you're not happy with the results, you know, what's a little bit of knowledge gonna hurt, right? Laws governing the universe, how things work. Why would you not? At least that was my engagement.
It's fear. Look, inside here, inside this little bubble that you call your world, even though you know that there's another community somewhere else, even though you know that that city block is meant for you, and you're never meant to get out of that city block, never meant to get out of it, and you won't question it. You will not question why you cannot get out of the city block. You'll look for every excuse to say no, but you cannot deny that you cannot get out of that city block. It has cells of recognition. It's what you know how to do. You can never deny the truth. Out here in the no thing, this is what frightens people. You have no cells of recognition out here. So that scares people. They'd rather stay stuck their whole life and keep living the same way over and over again, to experience the same things over and over again, to never know the truth. Because they don't know how. Well, I'm telling you right now, we've got the information to show you how to do that. But there's one thing you can never deny yourself, and that's yourself. You can never outperform the self-image. Some of you have tried, some of you have tried, and you feel like you've got all this horsepower, but you can't go anywhere. That's because you weren't programmed to go any further than where you're already at. If you've met that barrier that you don't know how to get further, if you've met the resistance, it's because you are not programmed to have what you're going after. And if you want that, you got to be willing to unlearn and relearn.
Abraham, speaking of the not having the programming, when you're seeking that ultimate goal, there are many steps, and you want those steps. Your ultimate goal includes fact-finding and a higher level of experience and learning that you must go through to reach that goal or gain that specialized knowledge. So, in essence, once you go through that process, where many times you have to question yourself, say, all right, that didn't work, what's next? And ask the universe for help. You now have a skill set that you can replicate. So that ultimate goal achieving model or new paradigm of specialized knowledge, you can go out and scale that and accomplish whatever you want to accomplish. Then it becomes easy. You become limitless, and you realize the possibilities are you realize that your possibilities are infinite.
Correct. But a lot of people will change that bulb from 10 watt, let's say it was 6 watt bulb, a 5 watt bulb, and they may do put in one more watt and then go back and keep upgrading. You can always go down, but how can you go up? They don't want to go up any further. It hurts to grow. If they put two more watts in there, they get a little bit further, you had so much more to go. You could express so much potential, but you're only expressing what you know how to do, the cells of recognition. So every time, right now, I left my cells of recognition many years ago, and I keep upgrading my unlearning and relearning so I can keep growing, because I know that the future is whatever I want it to be. I know that there's limitless power inside of me. So I keep changing the bulb, the hell with that bulb. And I can always decrease. I could always go back and decrease the volume, but I don't want to go back there anymore.
Incandescent LED.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, I want it, but if I want to go further than what the bulb was made to do, I've got to be willing to unlearn and relearn. I've got to go outside the box. I've got to go into the unknown, and I've got to push myself to go through the things that I don't want to do to grow.
What should you do?
Well, Abraham, that gets down to welcoming challenge. By definition, challenge is the objective or query as to the truth of something. Challenge isn't a negative thing. It's a discovery process of the steps that you have to go through. So people have to learn, and part of the education has to be taking on and accepting the challenges.
You're right on. And normally, a lot of people don't realize what they're doing or realize what they're not doing, and that's why they stay stuck. But that's the process, and it's a continued process if you want to continually change the boat. you want more light, you want to express more light, you want to receive and release more light, you're the center. You're the only one that can do it. We're a little past our time. We're going to go into our meditation. Everyone that's on Facebook Live, thank you for attending. Calmness of mind. And relax. Allow yourself to dream. This is where your fantasy can become a fact. You cannot set the direction or the target if you don't know where you're going. What do you want? Welcome back. Everyone have a great day.